My name is Mark Mayer. I am the senior educator of contemporary art here at the Asian Art Museum, and I wanted to welcome you all tonight. Before we begin, if anybody thinks that they will need an assisted listening device to help them hear the lecture, we have a few in the back, and my colleague John is waving if you need it, so he'll be able to provide them to you. So it is with great pleasure that I introduce tonight's lecture with Billie Tsien. It is part of our new lecture series that's co-organized with California College for the Arts and their architectural division, and with the intent of focusing on Asian architecture today. So 2 weeks ago, we hosted our kind of launch of the series that we hope is an annual occurrence with Korean architect Min-Suk Cho, the founder and principal of Mass Studies. I'm really excited about this collaboration because it not only builds a relationship between CCA's architecture division, but it also builds a stronger connection with architecture students and practicing architects. This series acknowledges also the unique identity of the Asian Art Museum, because so much of our collection can be seen and understood through a design lens in a really dynamic and important way. And it's my hope by featuring some of the most prominent voices in architecture that it will kind of harness this. And while it might seem like a stark difference with the art that we present here, it is my hope that it also creates a sense of continuity between the craftsmanship and design looking through the field of contemporary architecture. For me, tonight's presentation is kind of poignant. When I began my museum career in New York City over a decade ago, my very first public program I produced was in collaboration with the American Folk Art Museum and MoMA in New York. And I remember working at MoMA, and through many visits to the Folk Art Museum, I can distinctly remember, A, that first encounter of trying to find the door, which was amazing, but also I really appreciated the stark contrast in materiality, scale, and humanness between the two buildings. I can only describe it as New York at its best, alive with seeming contradictions, simultaneously peacefully coexisting. This building was designed by Billie Tsien and Todd Willilams, and for me, it's a space I hold on to both personally and professionally. So in conclusion, I wanted to thank CCA, specifically Jonathan Massey, and the staff of the Architecture Division for working with us to imagine the series and produce these two events. And we hope that next winter, spring, we'll see you again. And without further ado, I want to welcome Jonathan Massey to the podium. Thank you.
It's done a great number of schools, university buildings, libraries, and museums. Mark mentioned the American Folk Art Museum. We could add the Barnes Collection in Philadelphia, the Asia Society Hong Kong Center, and across the bay, the CV Star East Asian Library at UC Berkeley, among many others. The practice makes work that is humanist and phenomenological in its orientation, with an attention to materials, craft, detail, and to human experience that yields exceedingly rich textural and spatial experiences. Just the other day, I was at Cranbrook Academy, just north of Detroit in Bloomfield Hills, and had the chance to walk through what must be one of the great swimming pools of the world, the Cranbrook Natatorium, done by the firm for the school, which includes things like operable doors and windows and even operable skylights, so that you can imagine swimming in this glorious pool as snowflakes, you know, drift down through the roof and land in your lane. Billie Tsien studied art at Yale and architecture at UCLA before joining her husband Todd Willilams in practice. And they have been principals of their firm for 3 decades now. They operate on an atelier model with close engagement of the principals and a limited number of staff on just 6 to 8 projects at any given time, so that they can give each work a kind of attention that would be dissipated if they scaled up and expanded their firm. And partly for this reason, the firm is really cherished by its clients, I know, and by the occupants of its buildings, and also by their fellow architects, for many of whom TWBTA epitomizes an aesthetically and ethically compelling mode of practice. Billie has also made an impact on the field of by teaching, by lecturing in venues such as Samsung Hall here, and currently as board president of the Architectural League of New York. Please join me in welcoming her.
In trying to think about what this lecture was going to be, I started to look through some old photographs because I don't know whether I would characterize the work that we do as clearly Asian, but I would say I know that I am Asian American, and I think the work is a blending of strains of two cultures, two people. That said, I lived a very American life. So my parents came from Shanghai in 1949, and they were studying at Cornell University in Ithaca. So I was born in Ithaca, and my younger brothers were all born also in the United States. So we are ABCs, for those of you who know what that means, American-born Chinese. At the same time, even as we're part of a kind of mainstream American culture and we grew up in the suburbs, we always felt different, because we were different. And at one point, my father, I think he must have been very frustrated by work or something that happened to him, and he said to me, you know, you may think that you are white, but everybody sees you as yellow. And that was a kind of moment of, a kind of icy moment. But I realized what he said was true. I both belonged and did not belong. And in a way, what happens when you belong and you don't belong, I think, is that you develop a very strong interior life. And so what's inside becomes very, very important to you. And sometimes, this is, you know, from our son's kind of rock collection from when he was little, where you sort of put the black light on it and it turns the rock many colors. Sometimes I always sort of felt like the rock on top, the one who was always sort of quiet and shy, but I also felt like I had many, many colors. These are actually two images from a young photographer named John Edmonds. And they were a very powerful image for me because it was about a sense of a person, but that person has their back turned. And so I feel in terms of how I am, how we work, that there's both a very strong presence, but there's a very strong sense of withholding. So the interior of our buildings, and we talk about this with our students, the interior of the work that we do is what comes first. So when we design from the inside out. The inside is more important to us than the outside. But, you know, this is not work that I do alone. I work with my husband and partner, Todd Williams. And as I was saying to, you know, people the other day, when you work together and you live together, whatever time you've worked together is doubled. So I think we've got about an 80-year career going here. But at the same time, I couldn't imagine being with anybody else and working with anybody else. Because to begin with, we are incredibly different. So I'm going to show you three images. We were in a small a program that the Guggenheim put on called The Power of Two. So they asked a lot of people, work couples, life couples, to sort of talk about working together. And so I decided that I was going to take three images and project them as my thoughts about what Todd was like, and I wasn't going to show him, and then he would do the same for me. So my first image was this running man, because Todd is a very physical person, and he's always, always active, and hates to be in any way contained or slowed down. He was horrified by this, because, I mean, he thought that I was going to have these sort of very thoughtful, wonderful, amazing things. So the second one, as you can see, is a mouth. And the reason I put that up is because, for better or worse, he is the most honest person I know. And whatever he believes in, he will say. Whatever he thinks, he says. And that is totally the opposite from me, because very much everything for me is internal. And before I ever say anything, I've probably thought it through three times. So in that way, we're the opposite. And then a flashlight, because I think of him as sort of shining a bright light, being incredibly focused in what he does, and that light just sort of fixes on a particular problem, and he is passionate about it. So then the three that he showed for me. So this is the great painting by Carpaccio, and indeed he said that this was because I am actually an indoor person, and I do like to make a sort of connection to the landscape, but it's always through a window. And I like to be surrounded by many objects and books and things that I love. And this one, a sort of, once quite, I told him he was being a little too Asian here, but as, you know, as I said, I didn't have any choice. It was what we saw during the presentation. So this one, he said, was because although I seem to be, and this is Ryongji, and it's an incredible garden where you can look but you can't enter, and even as you look, you never see all of the stones at one time. And so he says that he feels that I always keep some part of myself hidden. And then this image, I know he is going very deep into the Asian imagery, but he said that this one was because when I get mad, I'm like the Great Wall of China. It lasts for centuries, but it's very sort of stoic and silent. So these are the two poles of our practice. And we try to find a kind of balance between the two. And although I certainly don't see myself as, in many ways, I guess, culturally Chinese, I know that I am psychologically very Chinese. And I see Todd, who sort of transplanted himself from Michigan, from the Midwest, to New York City, is not now culturally from the Midwest, but his sort of honesty and directness is very psychologically from the Midwest. So we're coming together, and it expresses itself in our work. We have lots of fights. Now that we've gotten older, I look around when we have these big discussions and fights in the office, and I see the people in our office looking at us, and it's this feeling of like kids saying, "Mommy, Daddy, please don't fight," you know. But they also, I think, have a kind of confidence that we share values, and the values are very strong, and they unite us almost like two trees and roots below the ground. So I thought that today I would talk just about five projects, and some of them have a very direct connection to things that are connected to Asia, and some of them don't. This is an early project that we did for the Noguchi Foundation, and we were able to go to visit Noguchi in his studio in Long Island City before it became a museum. And they decided they wanted to put on a show of the Ikari, the paper lanterns. And I think when Noguchi was first producing these Ikari and they were sold in department stores, he was criticized because people said, you know, you're really demeaning your art and making it commercial. And he said, well, actually, no, this is a way that people who aren't wealthy can buy sculpture, and it also lights their living rooms. So this idea of art and use together, I think, is many ways how we think about architecture. So the lamps themselves are very sculptural. You know them well. But what we decided to do was make an installation that both showed the lamps, but also, in a way, hid the lamps. So we designed a series of fiberglass screens that divided up the space and separated the lamps one from the other. But the way I like to look at the lamps best was through the screens. So you didn't see the legs, you didn't see the wires, but you saw the glowing shape of the lamps and had a sense of a sort of mystery about them before you went around to the backside and saw them for real. Thank you for talking about the Folk Art Museum. It is actually a very still a loved project for us, but I also think it has very much to do with this sense of concealing and revealing. So the Folk Art Museum had a tiny site. It was 40 feet by 100, so that white square, which is a little difficult to see, is the site on 53rd Street. It was a building that was devoted to folk art, which is art by untrained artists. So it ranged anywhere from decoys, quilts, to things like outsider art, which was often done by people who were disabled in one way or another or in prison. It's all quite small and very much about a connection between a sort of impulse and the hand, and not necessarily by people who have training. And so we wanted very much to make the building have a sense of tactility so that it felt as if it were made by people. And we worked with the Talix Foundry. So what you saw was some of the panels of the facade, and they were cast at this foundry. I'm going to go back. First in a kind of test casting, and those are, Todd and I are sort of just trying to understand the technique of casting, so these were cast on sand. And later they produced 53 panels, and those panels became the face of the building. The building is quite small, and what we were trying to do, if you remember The Running Man, Todd is very interested in how you move through the space, so he kept on thinking about the Guggenheim and somehow ended up with this early sketch, which was a terrible failure because he was trying to kind of squeeze the Guggenheim into a little shoebox. But what stayed was this sense of wanting to see the space from front to back and from top to bottom. At the same time, there's a very solid face in front. So this idea is that you come in and that you then understand much more than you expected, and you are surprised. For those of you who are architects, I just wanted to show these plans because each floor was a different floor plan. And it's kind of the opposite of a sort of standard, a kind of white neutral gallery. We were trying to make spaces that had an intimacy to them so that you could look at the work in a very, very direct way rather than feel as if they were small pieces floating in a large gallery. So this is a sectional model, and it shows a kind of skylight at the very top, and then the skylight drops down to the very bottom. And the next image next to it, when you entered the lobby, you could see all the way up to the skylight. The ground floor also had a skylight in the back. So one of the things that we are interested in working with, and you'll see it in the next few projects, is this sense of changing light. It's a way of connecting people to time. And when you're connected to time and seeing the light change, you also have a sense, I think, of being alive. So the interior was quite rough. The floors were polished concrete slabs. And one constantly sort of looked back into this big skylit area, and that was always the space around which you walked. So this building was eventually bought by the Museum of Modern Art and demolished. So it's also interesting to think about work, and I think this is what we do. We try to always think about work lasting for hundreds of years. And everything we build is built in a way so that it will last through time. But it's also important for us to realize that time does things and you can't control it all. So this is another link. This is the East Asian Library, C.V. Starr Library at Berkeley. And it was a very long-term project for us because it went through a number of different sites. And essentially, we're modernist architects. And so the Berkeley master plan asked that we work within the vernacular of a kind of Spanish style, which was sort of weird because it was an East Asian library and it was sort of a Spanish style. So we had a pitched clay tile roof, and they asked that things essentially be a symmetrical sort of facade. But we pitched the tile roof quite, the slope wasn't very high, and we also had actually an irregular facade, but covered it with a screen of cast bronze that gave it the appearance, at least in the daytime, of being very solid and therefore being symmetrical and hiding the asymmetry of the actual use of the space. And here you see, actually from the inside, it was very, very transparent. But it's a very simple box. One of the things we are also finding in our work is that we often simplify the shapes of our buildings in order to make the buildings more rich on the inside. But this is a box, we describe it as a box of books cracked open by light. So at the top, there's a very big skylight that lets in the light. You can't see where it's coming from, but once again, it's that changing, shifting sense of day. We also have, facing not the the main quadrangle, but facing to the north, larger windows that don't have the screen so people can take advantage of the incredibly beautiful campus. We're very interested in details. I was saying to the students today at CCA that all of our work for the first 15 years was done primarily with interiors. And I think it taught us a lot because we believe that it all begins with the human scale and what you touch with your hands. And so that's always something that we think about as we do any work. It's what you touch with your hands, it's what you feel. And there was a very tiny budget for the interior. And so they gave us permission to scan some of the images that were in the collection, and we worked with Millikan, and they printed these walk-off mats for us. So these are the kinds of mats that you see at the airport where, you know, it's sort of like Premier Lane, or, you know, outside of a bar, it says, you know, sort of somebody's bar, but you can actually send them a file and they'll scan those images. And we use those, these walk-off mats, pinned to the wall to give a sense of character to the library. And we worked on this with our great friends from TEF. And Alyosha is here, so I say thank you very much for all that you gave, because you're so much a part of it. And then this is the Asia Society in Hong Kong. So Jack and Susie Wadsworth are here. I heard the story that Jack was looking for a site for the Asia Society, and there was a site that had been fenced off and had the army barracks from the British there. And somehow or other, I heard the story that you climbed over the fence and jumped into the middle of the site and decided that this was the place that would be the home for the Asia Society. So I thank you very much for climbing that fence, and I'm really glad that you didn't get arrested and put in jail. It was close, yeah, I'm sure. And probably not the first time you did something like that, too. So the red rectangle is the site at Magazine Gap. And the thing that's truly amazing, even for New Yorkers, about Hong Kong is how it is such an incredibly vertical city. I was stunned when I went there, and I love the sense of these very, very tall buildings. And then when it becomes too crazily steep, everything turns green. And this is really kind of at the edge where things have started to really turn green and become a jungle. So during the early sort of settling of Hong Kong, the water, the harbor, came in much, much closer to where it is now. And through a series of landfill projects, the land has been brought out further and further. But there was a time when these barracks, in the British barracks, were able to act as a sort of munitions factory and storage place for British warships. And the munitions, the black powder, could go down by kind of sort of aerial trolley car. And when we first went there on our kind of a site visit, because this was a competition, I felt like I was somehow locked into an Indiana Jones movie, because everything was overgrown, huge banyan trees growing out of the roofs, and apparently people seem to be kind of camping out there. And you can still see the tracks in that picture in the upper right, where the trolley cars filled with munitions would be running along the tracks before they went down on the wires into the harbor. So these images show what's happened over time to Hong Kong, because essentially the British flattened out the hillside and made a flat plain. They built their buildings on that flat plain, but eventually these tall buildings grew up around it. And this was our first model for the competition. And what we proposed was a horizontal building in a vertical city. And so what you see on the far side, there's a nullah, which is a sort of drainage stream that takes the water rushing down from the mountain. On the far side is this horizontal building, which is the home for the Asia Society. And for those of you who may not know it, it was founded by the Rockefellers in order to promote understanding between the East and the West. The new building has a series of meeting rooms and a cafe and offices. And then crossing the nullah, there's a kind of Z-shaped bridge, and then a restoration of the original British munitions buildings. And actually, this is an image taken from the Conrad Hotel after the project was finished. So very much, this is a building that is looked down upon from all the tall buildings around it. So really, the roof is its most prominent facade. And there were fruit bats who were supposedly endangered living in the trees on the other side of the nullah. So we originally had a very straight bridge, but then the bridge became a kind of Z-shaped bridge in order to avoid the habitat of the fruit bats. But I also think it sort of relates to the bridges that you see in Chinese gardens that sort of zig and zag in order to keep out the bad spirits. So hopefully this also was keeping out the bad spirits. And then the buildings in the back with the tile roofs are the original Victorian buildings. But what's also interesting is that not only were the buildings heritage buildings, the berms in between were heritage landscape, because the berms were constructed in order to prevent explosions from going from one building to another and causing a huge conflagration. So these berms are also part of the architecture of the upper site. And so there were the old laboratory where new offices have been put, a building called Magazine A, which became the art gallery, and then a building called Magazine B, which was transformed into a small theater. It's a very, very steep site, and it's one that has a sense still, I think, of the jungle around it. So that great banyan tree that you saw in the first image still survives, and really the building is kind of tucked behind the green that is around it. So this first building was restored and became an office building, and the outside walkway was glassed in. This is the facade of the big building that's the horizontal building. And here we used a stone that came from Southern Asia. And it's a very sort of dark green stone, and we felt it very much reflected the sort of sense of the jungle. But what also happens, and maybe I'll just flip back, is that as you approach, you have the sound of water. And as you get closer and you go through the building, you realize that water is dropping from the roof into a pool, and there's only a small slot window at the entry that lets you look in and realize that there's a land beyond the wall. So once again, this idea of slowing the experience is very important to us, and keeping things, I guess, quiet until you sort of walk through and then you find that sense of surprise. So at the very top, you walk through from the lower level and you reach that upper level. The walkway is has a double height on it so that you're able to walk undercover during the monsoons and walk on the top level when the weather is good. At the very, very top is a sort of extended canopy that we made, and it certainly relates back to Chinese gardens. And we also restored those metal pathways where the little small trolleys would run. On the inside, this is the laboratory building. So all of the teak windows were restored, and there are new clay tiles made to replace the old. And then this is continuing through the site and entering into the Magazine A, which is where the art gallery then was installed, continuing through the site underneath this walkway. One enters Magazine B, which is where the theater was installed. And it was sort of interesting because theaters always need a kind of runaround where you run around behind the stage. And it naturally was a building like that because they stored the powder inside, and they had a very narrow hallway which went around the edge, because when people were carrying, at that time, lanterns with actual flames, they were never supposed to go inside to the center box where the powder was stored, but needed to run around. So in many ways, it led itself exactly to the program. So here, this image is at the top, and you see the fountain where the water drops down to the entry level, and you understand that this is about a horizontal plane. It is a garden floating above a more wild jungle, and it is a connection back to the wildness that still exists in Hong Kong. So this is a project that is now not particularly connected with Asia, but I think it continues to be an expression of both the sensibility that is East and West. We were chosen to do a project called the Barnes Foundation. And we often come to projects with a very simple idea, and we try to show that idea with a sort of sketch. So the Barnes Foundation was an amazing collection of Impressionist art that was amassed by a man named Henry Barnes. And its original home was in an arboretum or a garden in Marion, Pennsylvania. The collection was not very much visited and was in an area that was very residential and was really having huge financial problems. So the trustees decided to move it to downtown Philadelphia. So we said, if you're moving it to a city, to downtown Philadelphia, you need to bring a sense of the garden with you. And you need to give that sense of, if this was a gallery in a garden, you need to bring the sense of the garden into this new gallery because you're going to be in Philadelphia. So this is a image of the building that was designed by Paul Cray in Marion. It's a kind of neoclassical building. Paul Cray was the sort of master and teacher of Lou Kahn and at that time head of the architecture school at the University of Pennsylvania. And for those of you who don't know the Barnes Collection, Dr. Barnes believed that there was a very special way that you could learn to look at art if you were not trained to look at art. And his was very close friend was John Dewey, who believed that one could have, that a democracy is made stronger by education. So his belief was that if you put these paintings up, and you'll notice every wall is bilaterally symmetrical, you would understand if you looked from one Renoir nude to another Renoir nude, you're looking at shape, color, and form. And then you might see in between hardware, which started to echo the shapes of the women's bodies. And then you'd start to make visual connections between the paintings and the hardware, between the color. And so you could start to look at art without being afraid of not knowing who the painter was, not knowing what particular style it was. You could enjoy it because you would make relationships between visual relationships. And it was actually a very, very powerful experience for many people. He was adamant about not letting what he considered to be the elite into his collection. And he actually, James Michener, the writer, he was a college student, and he tried to sneak in under the guise of sort of wearing rough clothes. And Barnes found him out because he would sort of stand by the door and inspect people and sort of threw him out as soon as he found out. And it turns out Le Corbusier tried to come and visit the collection, and Barnes set up, told him the only appointment was 3 days after Le Corbusier's ship was scheduled to leave. So he was a curmudgeon, but an interesting curmudgeon. So the move was very controversial because a group called the Friends of the Barnes sued to keep the collection in place. In the end, the judge ruled that the collection could move in order to save the collection, but two things had to happen. The ensembles, the ones that you saw, had to stay intact, and the gallery sequence had to remain the same. So we looked at a neoclassical plan. I'm sorry, this is for more maybe the architects. And it's bilaterally symmetrical as a plan. And what we saw was you could essentially take a kind of scissors and cut off the end galleries and insert a kind of place of repose, a kind of place of respite, which would break up the sort of intensity of looking at this art. So this was our idea, and it eventually became our plan. So the gallery itself is quite, is really a kind of mirror of the existing gallery, but it has inserted within it both an interior courtyard and a study space. And the building is on the Franklin Parkway, so you can see it sort of in the far right. We felt that we wanted to be both connected and separate. It was sort of like growing up in the suburbs of New Jersey. You're both in there and you're not in there. So we believed that the building needed to have a kind of form, a mass that was similar to the buildings that are on the Franklin Parkway. So the buildings that are there are limestone and Tennessee marble, and they have a kind of formality to them. At the end of the axis is the Philadelphia Museum of Art. When we went in to see the, to be there for the interview, we showed this very small model, and it started out as a wooden model, and we kind of split it and told them the idea about dropping in these new pieces of what we felt would be a kind of break in the experience. And then the bar at the bottom is really the bar of the museum, of the foundation reproduced. Then there's an L-shaped building which has all of the sort of backup that modern collections need, and in between is a light court. And it's going back to the thought of the sort of light at the East Asian Library, this light that gives you a connection to the time of day. The building facade itself is very, very solid, and it's made out of panels of Jerusalem stone. In the end, we looked at limestone, but the limestone today is very, very consistent, and therefore it really looked just like concrete. We looked at Tennessee marble, which is a very pink. Much of Washington, D.C. is made from that, but now they're not able to quarry big pieces. So the stone that we found that was in between sort of limestone and Tennessee marble was this stone from the Negev. We also looked at the collection of Dr. Barnes. He was a very serious collector of African art and textiles. So this is a kente cloth, which is woven in strips and sewn together. And so we started to think about these strips of irregular stone that would have a kind of three bands to them. And those bands are very much related to the tripartite sort of neoclassical work of Paul Cray. So one walks across along a very long pool of water and sees that although it is solid, there are windows, but the stone is quite variegated. At one end, one looks back to the Franklin Library. And at the entrance, once again, it's not a direct entrance. The door is not in the front. It's towards the garden. You walk through a garden to get there and enter into this light court. So it's thinking about what we did at Berkeley. And it is, in many ways, even more protected than the Berkeley skylight, because you never ever see the sky through it. You only see the light changing. We worked with a Dutch artist named Claudia Jongstra, who developed these silk and felt wall panels to connect both to the stone and to the light. And this is a changing art gallery looking back into the light court. And this is the entry into the Barnes, the actual collection. And once again, thinking about these African motifs, this is Todd's drawing of a kind of metal panels that were used as money. And that became a screen which closes off the gallery when it's after hours. So people who come to the collection say, it's amazing you kept the wooden windows just as they always were. But if you look at this image, that was the way they were, and they were painted metal. And they were almost always kept closed because the glass technology wasn't so developed. And this is the way it is now. So sometimes you're able to create a memory of a space that is what people would want to remember more than what is actually there. So everything actually has been changed. We've looked at and redone all of the paneling, looked at the wall covering, and most of all, changed and shifted the lighting, because that's made people feel as if all of the paintings have been cleaned, but simply the lighting has been hidden, and you don't know where it is. And then this is one of the rooms that was inserted, a kind of study room of quiet. And this is the kind of interior garden that was inserted. On the lower level is the bottom of that interior garden and a library and auditorium, and the shot of that interior garden. And then this image with the light box glowing at night. So I'm going to end with this image of actually a wonderful dancer who died about 10 days ago named Trisha Brown. And she was both a friend and someone we worked with. She had this amazing piece called If You Could See Me. And she did the entire dance with her back turned towards the audience. But the power of it was amazing. And I think that in many ways, I've always loved this piece because it's about emotion, but it's a kind of emotion that is in many ways held to oneself. I feel incredibly lucky to have found both my life partner and my architectural partner with Todd. And I do think our work falls into a sort of in-between world, one that is touching both very American values and very, very Asian values. In many ways, it's the combination of these cultures, which is what makes this country such an incredible country to be living in, and something that clearly we have to be very, very strong to protect now. Thank you. So,
Billie, you'll take some questions from the audience.
Okay, so this is always the time when the people who have to leave feel like they can't leave, but I would say you can leave if you want to leave. Okay, there's one back there. Okay, so actually, it's a kind of project of a lifetime, and we feel incredibly honored. What's happening now is discussing with the Obamas their vision, and trying to sort of interpret that vision as a, you know, program, as a series of activities. So they are, the reason I won't talk about it in specific is because they want to be the people who present that vision. And in many ways we're, I said, you know, we make boxes. We make boxes to hold the vision. What is quite, has been very moving is that when people from the foundation talk about this center, it is clear that, well, first of all, he's a young president and she is a young first lady. So they have a whole essential lifetime in front of them to do work. And so this is not going to be as much about a legacy as it is about the future. And I find that when we talk about change and hope, I think that that's very much what they're focused on. Jack. Oh yeah. So the site is in Chicago and it's Jackson Park. Those of you who know Chicago know it's on the south side. It's near the Museum of Science and Industry, and it's adjacent to the lagoon, and then lagoons adjacent to Lake Michigan. It was actually the site of the Chicago exposition. So, and it is part of a park series that is an Olmsted and Vox design, very much at the end of Olmsted's life. So there's Washington Park, which was one potential site, which is connected to the Plaisance. University of Chicago is to the north and south of the Plaisance. And then Jackson Park, which is closer to the lake. So it's about 16 acres of Jackson Park. Yeah. That's public, so I can say that. Yes.
I was just wondering if when you and Todd designed together, if you have sort of presumed strength or roles within a project, or if it's pretty much equal and back and forth in design?
Well, that's a good question. We should ask Jack. No. Well, Todd always says that, you know, we each have our strong personas, but the other person has the shadow side of that strong persona. So I would say that if you make a kind of, so whatever I say is the characteristic, know that it's still also lodged in the other person. So he's probably like the running man, the first person to jump in. So he'll have a sort of idea that is quite powerful, but he's not here, so sometimes it's very garbled. And then I am sort of sitting at my desk looking out the window and therefore thinking about how to simplify it and clarify it. He's very interested in, I mean, and he really does move and see in three-dimensional space. And I think I still see as a painter. So I see things sort of flat, but I see them as a sequence of events. So I'm very much aware of how it's a different kind of movement. If his is sort of walking and moving through, I'm always looking for a place to sort of sit and, you know, read my book. So we argue a lot. We do argue a lot. But I think we have trust now that there's an underlying agreement that will eventually resolve itself. Yes.
Mentioning Berkeley's East Asian Library, you were talking about light through the course of the day, and I use the library all the time, so I have a lot of experience with it and love it. And I just wanted to report something that really surprised me this past winter, and that is what the light is like in there in the rain, of which we had a great deal of experience. And I don't know how it, I mean, I know how the building works, but I don't know how it worked, that somehow the building became warmer in the rain than it is in the sunshine. I don't know what you did, but it's wonderful.
I'm so glad that you didn't tell me. I was really flinching because I thought you were going to tell me, and there are leaks. Thank you.
We have time for one last question, if there is one.
There's one back there. Oh.
I had read an essay on your website about on slowness, and I understand that was written some time ago. And I was wondering if you could talk about now how much work you do by hand versus what the role is of the computers in your work.
Well, when we're producing all of our technical drawings, it is all on the computer. When we work with the people in our office, they will bring us drawings that are printed out, and then we draw by hand on top of them. So I used to say that, you know, we would get sort of the graphite on our hands and be really dirty. What we get on our hands now is actually whiteout, and that's a lot harder to get off your hands than graphite. But, you know, we're sort of whiting things out and then drawing on top of them. I think that it's very interesting to me because I find that so many students who live in the very fast world are somehow very interested in this essay about slowness that was written 20 years ago. And I think that there's a sort of connection between your head and your hand going back to sort of folk art, and that is more tentative and therefore gives you a little bit more time to think. And I think we all are looking for a little bit more time to think. And so drawings that are printed out look like they have all the answers. And we all need more time to think about what the questions are.
I was lying. We have one last question. I apologize. I hope you'll indulge me.
Why did you choose to be an architect?
Okay, that's the best question ever. So, I actually didn't think that I was going to be an architect. I thought I was going to be an artist. And then when I was in art school, I found that I couldn't decide whether I liked my work or not. And I would draw something, and then I couldn't decide whether it was good or bad. So I thought, I need to do something that allows me to figure out whether I did a good job or a bad job. So I went to architecture school, and what was really interesting, well, there are a bunch of things that were interesting. One is that you get to stay up all night and have a good time with a lot of other people your age and work, and that was really fun. So what I really liked was you don't work by yourself, you work with other people. And what I also liked was they gave you problems that you had to solve in a kind of artistic way. And because they were problems, you could figure out whether you had done a good job or a bad job. And I really liked the idea of trying to solve other people's problems. So I didn't start out to be an architect, but I kind of walked in sideways, not really knowing what it was about. But luckily I found out that I really, really liked doing it. So that's how. And thank you for that question.